Hello, welcome to a lecture on Introduction to Theories of New Media. In this video, I will be discussing an essay by Manuel Castells. Now, this essay is actually the introductory chapter of the book The Network Society, From Knowledge to Policy, published in 2006 and edited by Manuel Castells and Gustavo Cardozo. The opening chapter is also titled The Network Society, From Knowledge to Policy. What do you mean by new media? It simply means new forms of digital media. So new media is a means of mass communication using digital technologies such as the Internet. Now, various new media tools include the computer, for instance, or your mobile phone or tablets and so on. Now, the earlier term used for new media was digital media. So, if the computer and mobile phone are new media tools, what is old media? So old media or traditional media refer to print media like newspapers and magazines, then broadcast media like radio and television. New media also includes social media sites like Facebook, Twitter, YouTube. It is also a tool used by new media. Online computer games, applications or apps used in your mobile phones and tablets. So all these are forms of digital media or new media. Now, what are the characteristic features of new media? New media is very popular because it enables access to free information. Information is easily available on the internet. For example, if you need to know the meaning of a word, immediately you would take your mobile phone and Google the word, and you will get a whole lot of options. Sometimes it is almost difficult to choose which will be the correct information that you actually need. Now, new media is also easily accessible. It has no time or space constraints. You can access it from anywhere you want, depending on your network connection. And it is mostly free. The information that you get is mostly free. Now, another important characteristic feature is the interactive nature of new media. Unlike old media, new media facilitates interaction with the user. The user can interact with the content given on new media on the internet, for instance. The user can also create and share content. Now, digital communication is another characteristic feature. So, as we already looked at the definition of the new media, it is a form of mass communication where you use digital devices like computers, mobile phones, and so on to communicate. Again, the content available on the net, for instance, is referred to as digital content. It can be in the form of text, it can be in the form of audio or video files, it can be images and so on. So anything available in the digital form is digital content. And new media uses a variety of tools, like, for example, to access social media websites. You need to log in, or you need to have an account on Facebook, or you can use WhatsApp. So all these are different kinds of new media tools. Now we come to the most important characteristic feature of new media that was discussed by Manuel Castells, and that is networking. So new media has given rise to the formation of networking or the formation of social groups on the internet. Now these social networks are virtual networks, but in these virtual networks we find groups of real people who interact with each other in order to stay connected or to share information, to share pictures, videos, etc. So So these networks of people who share information form online communities, also called virtual communities. So new media facilitates this kind of networking, and this is one of the most important characteristic features of new media. Again, another term that often comes up in media studies is media convergence. Now, an example would be the mobile phone you use. You just need one mobile phone, one device, and you can access a wide variety of media. Like, for instance, you can use your phone to make telephone calls, you can use it to send SMS, text, you can watch videos on YouTube, you can listen to your favorite music channels, you can access social media platforms, you can use WhatsApp to stay connected with your friends, you can listen to audiobooks, you can read ebooks, browse the internet, and so on. So all different kinds of media converge on your mobile phone. So this phenomenon is referred to as media convergence. Now, the author of the essay, The Network Society, From Knowledge to Policy, is Manuel Castells. He is a Spanish sociologist and a renowned academician associated with research on the information society, communication, and globalization. Now, his most important work is a trilogy published during 1996 to 1998. The trilogy is titled The Information Age: Economy, Society, and Culture. So these three books on the slide, these are the three books in the trilogy. The first one, The Rise of the Network Society. The second one, The Power of Identity. And the third one, The End of Millennium. Now, the other author who has co-edited the book along with Manuel Castells is Gustavo Cardoso. He is a Portuguese sociologist, mainly associated with studies in the fields of networked communication, journalism, and the internet. The term network society was first used by Castells in The Rise of the Network Society. This is the first book in the trilogy that was published in 1996. The term was not coined by him. It was coined by a Dutch author, but it was first used by him in this book. And as I've discussed earlier, the network society refers to groups of people who form a network online. Virtual networks. They are virtual networks of people, and it includes people from different parts of the globe. So what is a network society? This is what Castells defines. This is how Castells defines it. It is any society in the IT age where people are interconnected by digital devices like smartphones or computers with the internet connection. Now, what he mainly does in the article, in the introductory chapter, is to study the impact of the internet on communication models of contemporary societies. Now, this network is made up of individuals, businesses, and the state operating from the local, national, and into the international arena. The essay explores patterns and dynamics of network society. Now, dynamics refers to how the network society works. The topics in the book range from the knowledge economy based on technology and innovation to organizational reform and modernization in the public sector. It also focuses on the media and communication policies. Interestingly, this book discusses many things that are relevant today in the current age when the world is reeling under the threat of the coronavirus. So we find that many people are working from home. A lot of people use the internet. It is the only means of communication for them to stay connected with people, with relatives in other countries. And again, we find, for example, in the field of education, for instance, most educational institutions have already started thinking about the possibilities of online education, online teaching and learning, and so on. So, to put it very simply, these are the two things that we are going to discuss: how the network society operates and how the internet has made an impact on modern society or contemporary society. Now, according to Castells, networks constitute the new social morphology of our societies. So these networks are the basic units of modern society. And social networks process and manage information and are using microelectronic based technologies. So we find that Castells is making factual statements. He is emphasizing the fact that the network society is here to stay for a long time. So it is high time that we accept it as an authentic presence. Now this chapter has been divided into subheadings. Let's take a look at each one by one. The first is understanding social transformation. So with the emergence of the network society, a lot of changes have come. Castells tries to make us aware of the need to understand this kind of social transformation. Now, the first thing that he observes is that technology is a necessary condition today. Without technology, there would not be a network society. And it is a highly essential thing today. So it is a necessary condition for the emergence of a new form of social organization. And Castells has conceptualized the network society as the social structure resulting from the interaction between the new technological paradigm and social organization at large. So Castells is talking about how the interaction between the new technological tools like your mobile phone with an internet connection or the computer and the society has facilitated the rise of the network society. Now, interaction is a very important feature in network society. Again, digital communication networks are the backbone of the network society. And two things that are important here is how digital communication networks can be very flexible and also very adaptive. The network society is a new social structure and it is global. So that also is an interesting fact. The next subheading is the network society beyond myths, findings of scholarly research. Castells says that the rise of the network society or the development in technology is obstructed by many myths. For example, if you look at the current situation, many teachers and students as well are very apprehensive about the effectiveness of online teaching and learning. Even many parents feel that it would be dangerous, especially for school children, to spend too much time online without any kind of parental or teacher supervision. So let's take a look at the myths that Castells has mentioned in this essay. These myths include, the first one is that new technologies destroy jobs. So this again, I'm sure all of you are familiar with this. If anything, whenever anything new comes up, there is this fear, this concern that it will replace the human being. Again, another thing is that the internet isolates. They're like, for example, when people are looking or are addicted to video games, for instance, or online games, we find that they are detached from the family, detached from friends, and so on. So, again, the kind of alienation that internet gives to a person. Then again, another myth is that we suffer from an overload of information. There are psychological studies that say that this is a kind of a new age disease. overload of information, too much information. You Google for something and you get millions and millions of pages that offer different kinds of explanations. Again, this again is a very important fact about the digital divide, the divide between the haves and the have-nots, the rich and the poor. So this increases social exclusion. Again, coming back to what I mentioned earlier, the apprehensions regarding online teaching and learning. The fact remains whether all students will be included in this teaching learning process. So it can increase social exclusion. And again, that the technological development is controlled by the military, that, you know, everybody is watching us, the constant fear of surveillance. Again, some of the myths that he has listed. Tempo of our lives is relentlessly accelerated by technology. We don't have time for anything else. We are too much into technology, and it has we have made technology the master of our lives. So all these kinds of things. Again, the third world countries do not need technology, but the satisfaction of their human needs, with the rise in poverty, unemployment, starvation. So the general feeling that instead of spending money for technology, why don't you try to address the needs of the third world countries, the human needs. Again, most parents are anxious that children are spending more time messaging and chatting with their friends instead of reading books. So what will happen to them, and so on. And the fear that should they become, they are becoming increasingly arrogant, when on the other hand, the children actually know more more than their parents because of this constant exposure to the outside world through digital media or new media. And again, this again is a danger. Nobody knows who is whom in the internet. I'm sure I don't need to explain that. Again, work efficiency is hampered by technology that does not rely on human experience. Crime and violence and even terrorism use the internet as a privileged medium. And the last point that he makes is that we are rapidly losing the magic of the human touch. Now, for example, earlier we used to send letters to friends and relatives, and some of them treasure these letters, you know, these handwritten letters. They are treasured by most people, even birthday cards, for instance. But now with the internet, all this has changed. In order to send a birthday wish to someone, you either send something that is readily available online, or you just type out the message. So this is what Casas means by losing the magic of the human touch. So many people are apprehensive of this also, because we are slowly turning into machines and losing the magic of being human. Now, Castells compares the network society with the industrial society. He makes a reference to the Industrial Revolution. So Castells is trying to explain that these are some of the concerns expressed by the people living during the Industrial Revolution. Even they were apprehensive. And, you know, nothing bad has happened to humanity. We've only advanced further. So he tries to give us a kind of a mirror version. Mirror version is an opposite version when compared to the earlier myths. So he says that the rise of the network society, or the emergence of new advancements in technology, actually offers a rosy view, a very optimistic or a beautiful view of a paradise of human fulfillment and creativity induced by technological wonders. Now, some of the key developments in the transformation of labor and work. Now, the rise of the network society has led to some changes in labor and work. And the first point that he stresses is that technological change does not induce unemployment. So nothing bad will happen to the job sector because of the rise of the network society. Now, something innovative that has come up is the ability to work autonomously. So for example, when you stay at home, when you take work or you work from home, what happens is that there is nobody to supervise what you're doing, and you are your own boss. So this has led to the evolution of what Castells calls the self-programmable labor or self-programmable worker or employee. And again, labor can be replaced by machines. Outsourcing is also another development in the transformation of labor and work. Outsourcing is giving some parts of your work to people who are willing to work in other parts of the world. And for example, many American companies outsource their work to countries like India, for instance, where they don't have to pay much money to Indians, for instance. Cheaper labor is available here. So that is outsourced. Now, what are the characteristics of a network society? Again, this is a repetition of a few things that we've already discussed. The first thing is it is a society of network individuals, people who stay connected, people who interact with each other, people who share and exchange information, and so on. Now, the next is that network society is a hyper-social society. So Castells actually gives more importance to explaining this idea of a hyper-social society. He says the internet does not actually alienate people. Instead, it makes them hyper-social. Now, an example that I would like to give is about, again, Facebook, for instance. You know, some people who are really introverts or very silent in real life may be more vocal or more articulate and very active on social networking sites. So that is why he terms it as hyper-social, extremely social or over-social. And it is not a society of isolation. And the self-programmable employee, the concept that has emerged, that has led to the emergence of network individualism as the dominant culture. So though you're working within a network, within a group, there is no compromise on your individualism or individuality. Again, the communication of a network society is global as well as local. These are more characteristics. Technological malleability of the new media. The new media is very flexible and very adaptive. Again, this is also important. It has led to the emergence of self-directed mass communication. I'm sure you're familiar with these terms. Blogs. Blogs are video blogs, podcasts, streaming, and so on. So why does he call them self-directed? Because it is actually, showing the person, or it is actually projecting the person who makes these blogs, for instance, or this video, for instance. Though this lecture is about Castells' essay, I am also in a way directing the attention of the viewers to myself. So that is what he means by self-directed mass communication. Or a Facebook post, for instance, if someone puts up post something on Facebook, then he or she will have a few people in his friends group, in his or her friends group, who will respond to it. And so this is what he means by self-directed mass communication, projecting yourself on the new through the new media. Again, this is an important point. He says Castells emphasizes the fact that virtuality has become the foundation of reality. So this is the new kind of reality that we are living in, and that is virtuality. Now Castells comes to key policy issues in the network society. He talks about how certain reforms have come, certain changes have come, for example, in the form of e-governance. If you need something from an office, for instance, or a government office, all you have to do is to go online and you can get the document ready in no time. You don't need to run from table to table in an office or from office to office. Then again, e-learning, we've already discussed that, the facilities for online teaching and learning. Again, the evolution of the self-programmable worker or the self-programmable employee. And Castells says that the network society actually redefines the condition of shared growth in the world. So when you work within a network, all of you are growing together. Again, there is a redefinition of intellectual property rights. This is about sharing of free information. Castles also points out the dilemmas of our time. There are a few people who still claim or who still try to escape from being drawn into this. They say the most common excuse that we often hear is that I am not tech savvy. So he says that humans are the crossroads. So they now have to take a choice. They are at the crossroads of the development of the network society. So whether to join a network society or not, the choice is yours. Again, he talks again about the intellectual property rights, about the amount of free information that is disseminated through various forms of new media. Now, again, in this context, I would like to make a mention of the fake news being circulated through WhatsApp and through other forms of new media. So there you have the issue of intellectual property rights. And again, Castells talks about communication democracy versus political control. So this again, we see, when people talk about, talk against a government policy, for instance, if it is on Facebook or WhatsApp, they feel that they have a complete freedom. So that becomes a conflict, that becomes an issue. So communication democracy versus political control. People are unable to take a stand. They don't know whether they are doing the right thing or the wrong thing. To conclude, what he has done in this chapter is to theorize globalized networked economy. This is just an introduction to the book. And again, he talks about how network forms, various network forms combine with global networks of ICT to create a new social form. And it is the new social form is termed as the network society. And one thing that he points out is that how this network form still has issues like domination and exploitation. So these are issues that you find even in network societies. So network form of global capitalism continues to represent a regime of domination and exploitation. Now, before I sign off, let me sum up by taking a quick look at what was discussed in this video lecture. We began with a discussion of the term new media and also about what old forms or traditional media are. Then we discussed Castell's explanation of the term network society. He explains that the network society is the new social unit. It has become the basic units of society. In this network society, people use digital-based technologies. Then Castells gives us an idea about how society has transformed because of the rise of the network society as a new social structure. We have also looked at the different myths connected with the rise of the network society. Castells compares the network society with the industrial society. And he talks about the key developments in the transformation of labor and work. Next, Castells lists some important characteristics of the network society. He describes it as a hyper-social society. And he remarks that networked individualism has emerged as the dominant culture. He also talks about the evolution of the self-programmable employee and the emergence of self-directed mass communication. Finally, Castells emphasizes that virtuality is the foundation of reality in the contemporary world. I hope you found this lecture useful. Thank you so much for your patient listening, and good luck.